Hello, this is Dr. David Tam, President and CEO here at BB Healthcare, and welcome to one of our Facebook Live video town halls for the public. And today is January the 8th, 2021. It is now 4:37, and I share that with you because we will be recording this and then posting it, and I want everybody to know when they're watching it exactly when this town hall was presented and recorded. Why do I do this? Because the fact of the matter is that the information that we present about COVID and the vaccine changes so fast on a regular basis in today's world, and that we will continue to deliver more information in all the ways that we can. But this is the best information that we can get to you, our community, on January 8th, Friday, 2021, at now 4:38 p.m. On behalf of all of us here at BB Healthcare, Happy New Year. Thank you so much for joining us today as we once again come together to share with you information about COVID, the vaccine, BB Healthcare, and what is happening to the community as a whole. You know, I hope you had a great Happy New Year's season. I know that we are all continuing to share the fear and frustration of what has transpired now for almost 10 months. I personally had a very quiet holiday season. And, you know, as many of you know, I did get my first COVID vaccine shot. I am scheduled to get my next COVID vaccine shot next week. You know, there is both a mixture of a sense of relief, a sense of hope, and a sense of excitement. But at the same time, we know that there is much work to do as we continue working together to fight the pandemic. Today, we're going to talk about a few things. We're going to talk about our continued focus on COVID and trying to keep community spread down, of which the vaccination is one part. Dr. Chazanov, Dr. Bill Chazanov, our director, medical director for COVID-19 and one of our three infectious disease physicians, is here to share with you the latest on what is going on with COVID-19 in the community and the vaccine and what we are doing here at BB Healthcare to prepare for vaccinating as many people here in Sussex County. I'm here to tell you that the three W's still apply, even as people are starting to get the vaccine. That is, we still need to wash our hands, watch our distance, and wear a mask. And Bill can talk a little bit about why the vaccine helps us in terms of building up our antibodies and helping us to prevent getting sick, but doesn't necessarily do anything about whether or not we're infectious and transmitting the virus in our nose and throats to other people who are vulnerable. We're working closely with the state as well as the federal government on making sure we do everything we can to help vaccinate. As you know, we are currently in something called Tier 1A, which is healthcare providers, because at the end of the day, it's not because we're better, not because we're more deserving, but to serve and protect the community, we must ensure force protection and maintaining the ability for BB Healthcare to provide comprehensive services to the people here in Sussex County. So we'll talk a little bit about the vaccination process here at the hospital and the health system, and then as we move forward to take care of all our other healthcare partners as well as other first responders, and we'll talk a little bit about how we're moving forward with our planning on helping to start vaccinating everybody else, 65 and older, and other people in the community as we move forward. I want to just share with you, though, that it is important that many things are still in a state of flux. We just received the vaccines, of course, literally 3.5 weeks ago, and that was almost a day or so after the emergency use authorization was made by the Food and Drug Administration and the Center for Disease Control. And so we've gone very quickly during the holiday season to move forward with this, but there is much more work to do. I can only commit to you, and I will reiterate this as we finish, that BB Healthcare has been here for 104 years to serve the community. And although we will continue to work with the state and all our partners, our focus is you, the community here in Sussex County, and we will do everything we can to ensure that we bring services, whether it be the vaccine or whether it be the hospital, beds, well visits, urgent care or walk-in care or emergency room services to you during this time. And so I'm going to turn it over now to Dr. Bill Chazanov. I just want to share with you that, you know, he represents the 3,000 people who work here at BB Healthcare. I know that he's been at the front of it, but the values that he represents are the values that all of our healthcare workers have as we continue to fight this pandemic. So, Bill, please go ahead and take it away, and then I'll be back later to close it up.
Thank you, Dr. Tam. I appreciate that. And for those of you who know me from the prior town halls, my name is Bill Chazanov. I am one of the three infectious disease physicians here at BB Healthcare. I grew up in Milford, Delaware, and I actually have lived in Delaware for the majority of my life. I did come to BB Healthcare about 3.5 years ago and have been very happy since I've come home. Like I say, I was born in Sussex County and now live back in Sussex County. I probably know some of you who are watching this town hall, and I thank you for your time. So here at BB Healthcare, I'm gonna tell you what we are seeing, not just from the ground level in the hospital, but I'd like to actually start off by giving everyone some numbers of what we are seeing throughout the world, and then come back down to where we are in our community, including here at BB. In the world, as of this morning, and this is since the start of the pandemic, and these numbers are a little astonishing, so bear with me. Since the start of the pandemic, there have been over 88.1 million cases of COVID-19 confirmed. In the United States, there have been 21.6 million cases of COVID-19 confirmed. Out of those known 21.6 million cases, we have unfortunately lost about 366,000 U.S. citizens because of COVID-19 or something that has been related to COVID-19. With that, when we move to the state of Delaware, we have had a total confirmed cases of just shy of 63,000. And out of those 63,000, we have unfortunately lost 949 state of Delaware residents. As of this morning, the state of Delaware reported that we had over 430 hospitalizations throughout the state of Delaware, and out of those 431 hospitalized patients throughout the state of Delaware, 57 of them were requiring intensive care level of care. So that's 57 out of those 431 patients hospitalized. In Sussex County, we have not been immune to this, and we have a total confirmed case number of 16,515 since the start of the pandemic. And unfortunately, we have lost 304 Sussex County residents to COVID-19 or something related to a manifestation or a complication of COVID-19. I do want to switch gears for a second, and I hope that those numbers sink into everyone. And want to actually talk about the hospital numbers for a moment. So that hospital number of 431 is in the range of the highest numbers we've seen since the start of the pandemic when it comes to the number of Delaware residents requiring hospitalization for COVID. So from when we saw our initial peak or our initial surge at the end of April 2020, and also that lasted through May of 2020 and then started to decline, these numbers now are higher than those numbers were about 8 months ago. When it comes to the virus, there are certain other things that we should discuss, and I'm sure that you are hearing a lot of this in the news. So there is a strain of the virus known as the UK strain, which its official strain is B as in boy, 117. The UK strain and the B.1.1.7 strain are the same strain of the COVID-19. It is not uncommon for viruses to mutate the longer that they have been around. We see this all the time in the flu, hence we have to receive a new flu shot every year because we know that the strains of the flu vaccine that circulate from one year to the next year are different. So very similar to that, there will be mutations in most viruses, including COVID-19. This UK strain, or this B.1.1.7 strain, is not more deadly than the wild type or the normal strains of the COVID-19 that we have. What is interesting and unfortunate about this B.1.1.7 strain, or the UK strain, is that it appears to be able to infect more people than the strain that we had several months ago that we knew about. So the more people that are infected by this strain means that more of those people will unfortunately require hospitalization and unfortunately could lead to more deaths. So even though the strain itself is not deadlier, there are more people that this strain can infect, which means that just from sheer numbers, there will be more people that require hospitalization, and unfortunately, that will lead to more severe illness. With that, one of the questions that I'm getting asked frequently is, are the vaccines that are now available and the vaccines that are in the pipeline to be released in the near future, will they still work on this new strain or these new strains of the COVID-19 virus? Well, as far as we know, the vaccines that are available now and the vaccines that are in the pipeline that hopefully will be released appear to have the same efficacy as they do on the other strains that we're aware of. So I think that that's very important. And that's also probably a good leeway into talking about the vaccine. The COVID-19 vaccine I've received several questions for, and it's going to be my pleasure to answer as many of these questions as possible, but I'm going to try to answer some of these questions as I talk to you over the next few minutes. So BB Healthcare, as Dr. Tam alluded to, received our first allotment of the COVID-19 vaccine on the afternoon of December 16th. We started to vaccinate our team members within hours of receiving that vaccine. Since that time, we have received other shipments of the vaccine, and we have offered the vaccine to every team member that now works at BB Healthcare. And that has all happened within the last several days, and we are very proud of that. As of this morning, we are proud to announce that we have vaccinated over 1,800 of our team members, and that's astonishing, and that also makes us extremely proud. The vaccine that we have received, like I said, was the Pfizer vaccine first, and then we have started to receive the Moderna vaccine. So before I talk to you more about what our plan is and what our plans are going to look like moving forward, I do want to take a moment to try to explain these vaccines a little bit. I think this is important. These vaccines use a technology that has been used for other therapies, such as cancer therapy and other therapeutics and other illnesses and diseases for several years. And this technology is not a new technology. This technology is normally not used for vaccines. So the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine are the first two vaccines that are using something called messenger RNA, also abbreviated as mRNA, as the technology to deliver us immunity, or at least some efficacy for immunity against this COVID-19 virus and the COVID-19 virus strains. So let me make that a little more simple. So normally when you receive a vaccine, you receive a special protein in that vaccine that we call an antigen. And when that antigen is injected into your body realizes that that's not supposed to be there. That is not something that normally should be there. So what your body does is it creates something called an antibody, and that's another protein. And that antibody comes and basically couples around that antigen, that foreign substance, that foreign material, that infection in this case, and it helps, it basically helps get rid of it. So what these vaccines are doing is, as opposed to giving you that antigen and injecting it, it's basically giving our body the blueprint to make that antigen. So our body actually creates the antigen. And then once that antigen is created by our body and it's in our own body's machinery, then the antibody comes and hopefully destroys that infection. Now, that messenger RNA does not become a part of our normal DNA, which most of us have heard of. This messenger RNA, as a matter of fact, is degraded very easy by our body. It does not last for very long. One of the things that many people have heard of about the vaccines is that this can be a vaccine that causes a lot of soreness in your arm where it is injected. Part of the reason for that soreness is because this messenger RNA has to be coated in a special lipid, so our body does not break it down before we're able to make that special antigen. So that's probably enough technical talk, but this is a newer technology for vaccines, but not a newer technology for therapies that we've been using for many, many years. So I do want people to understand that this is not a brand new technology that we've not used in medicine before. So I talked to you that right now, underneath something called an emergency use authorization, we have the Pfizer vaccine, and Pfizer joined forces with a company called BioNTech. So it's also known as the Pfizer BioNTech vaccine. So if you see that together, that's the same vaccine. We also have a second vaccine that had received emergency use authorization after the Pfizer vaccine. And that one comes from a company named Moderna, which begins with an M, Moderna. There are also other vaccines in the pipeline, including a vaccine that works differently than the Moderna and Pfizer vaccine, and that is from Johnson & Johnson. And then there is also the AstraZeneca, basically coupled with another company known as Oxford. And Oxford and AstraZeneca actually have a vaccine that has been approved in the United Kingdom already, but has not been approved in the United States. That AstraZeneca vaccine also uses a different technology than the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine that you guys were patiently listening to me try to explain to you. So I told you that we have vaccinated over 1,800 of our team members since we first started to receive vaccine shipment here at BB Healthcare. So as we vaccinated these 1,800 people, it's taken some time in order to do that. All of the healthcare workers that are here at BB Hospital all fit underneath the state of Delaware's Phase 1A, A as in apple, Phase 1A tiering system. And I do want to take a second to discuss what that tier looks like. So in Phase 1A, that includes all healthcare personnel, and it also includes residents and staff of long-term care facilities. So that's skilled nursing facilities, assisted living facilities, those who work in the hospital, those who work in long-term care facilities, and then many other people who are involved in providing patient care, either directly or indirectly. So what we do know is that we have, as our agreement with the state of Delaware, we have vaccinated our team members, and I think that we have done a nice job, but now it's time to do more. So this week, we have started to reach out to healthcare providers that are not employed by BB Healthcare to see how we can help. What can we do to help other healthcare providers in our community and in our area start to get the COVID-19 vaccine? Because they are also Phase 1A or Tier 1A healthcare workers. We have received several responses, and we are most appreciative of that. And as of this morning, and actually starting yesterday, we have started to vaccinate non-BB team members, non-BB healthcare workers. And we are very proud of that. We have taken this and we are expanding beyond what what we were asked to do to make sure that we are doing our part to keep everyone as safe as possible. With that being said, there are obviously limitations to this. There are some limitations to we have to rely on certain resources such as the state in order to get vaccine, which most of you are aware of. This is not something that we can just order and receive. We basically ask the state for this allocation for our vaccines. So that's wonderful. As Dr. Tam had alluded to, we know that we need to keep our healthcare infrastructure safe so we can keep everyone safe in this pandemic. And I first want to thank all of you who are listening to this. I do want to thank all of you who are listening to this for your patience, because whenever we hear that something's new that can potentially help us, we all want it, and we also want you to have it. So as the state has outlined their tier or phase 1A, they have also outlined a phase 1B, B as in boy. And these phase 1B members include other frontline essential workers. So there are a lot of frontline, first line responders in tier 1A. Some of the other first responders are in tier 1B. Then there are also educators, such as teachers and support staff and daycare members that are in phase 1B. There are food and agricultural workers. There are also grocery store workers and others that fit into that. State of Delaware has made the decision that in addition to those other frontline essential workers, that it's also important that persons that are 65 years of age and older also start to have access to the COVID-19 vaccine. So what does that mean? That means that we, as in we, the state of Delaware, all of us, will basically have a significant portion of people who will become eligible for the COVID-19 vaccine all at once, probably starting by the end of this month. So that is fantastic news. We are going to have many people who are now going to be eligible for the COVID-19 vaccine, be able to basically have the possibility of getting it. And now what we need to do is to figure out the safest and most effective way in order to get this vaccine distributed to those, honestly, tens of thousands of people in Delaware that will now be eligible for the COVID-19 vaccine. The state of Delaware is telling us that we should start to have vaccine for this phase 1B group by the end of this month. So I want you to know that just like everything else that we have done throughout this pandemic, BB Healthcare is trying to be at least two steps ahead of the game. We already have been strategically planning of how this rollout of vaccine allocation is going to be for our community, for our patients, for Lewis, for Sussex County, for Georgetown, for Millsboro, for all of us. So that way we can try to do this as fair as possible, as effective as possible, but also as efficiently as possible. One of the concerns that I hear a lot is, how can people be holding on to vaccine? Well, I think it's important to know that most of us are not truly holding on to lots of vaccine. We have been provided a mission to vaccinate our team members, and now we have expanded that to ensure that our tier 1A, even non-team members, are vaccinated. With that being said, we are using the vaccine that are kind of, quote, on our shelves in order to make sure that that happens. It's important to try to get as many tier 1A people vaccinated now, so that way, by the end of the month, we are not also trying to vaccinate tier 1A and tier 1B. Now, we're not going to tell tier 1A people that they cannot be vaccinated once tier 1B opens up, but it's important to know that if we can take care of tier 1A now, then we also have as much vaccine for tier 1B as possible, and we can focus as much as we possibly can on tier 1B. I will tell you that BB knows how to vaccinate people. We've been doing this for years, and we do this very well. For example, this year alone, we have vaccinated in our community flu clinics, which most of those were drive-through clinics, we have vaccinated over 5,200 community members in the matter of weeks. Now, we have also vaccinated 2,400 of our team members within 48 hours for the flu just a few months ago. So I am telling you that we know how to do this. If we get the vaccine, we are going to do our best to have a plan in place in order to make sure that everyone is as safely, effectively, and efficiently vaccinated that we can vaccinate. This is not just a BB thing, though. I want you to recognize this. This is something that is going to take a huge uplift from all of us. And I'm not just saying all of us for all of you who are listening. I'm talking about many organizations. This is going to take the work of local physicians, BB physicians or non-BB physicians. This is going to take the partnership of all the healthcare networks in order to get this done. We rely on the state of Delaware and the Division of Public Health in order to make sure that we have the necessary vaccinations in order to vaccinate everyone. So this is a partnership that is taking many, many partners and at different levels to be successful. So I do want you to know that BB has already and has already been starting strategic planning for this to make sure that when it's available, we are ready to go to start vaccinating those people in Tier 1B. What that is going to require is that's going to require some patience. So as we roll out vaccine, I am telling you that there will be more eligible people for vaccine than vaccine will be available at first. And I know that's going to seem unfair, and I also know that that is going to probably increase some anxiety. But I'm telling you that everyone who wants a vaccine should be offered a vaccine. It's just going to take some weeks in order to do that. We have made it this far. It is January 8th. It has already been a year since we started to first hear about COVID-19. And when we first started to hear about it, it did not even have a name. If you remember, it was called the novel coronavirus. Then we switched to COVID-19. Now those are basically synonyms. So I'm asking you to please be patient. Please be patient as this gets rolled out. And remember, the rollout is expected to occur for this phase 1B as in boy by the end of January. So it still gives us several days and few weeks to get more information in order to pass off to you. As more information does come to us, it's important to know that we will release that information. We will provide that information either in a town hall, or we will release that information through our website, through Facebook, and then also the state of Delaware has a delaware.gov coronavirus vaccine page that you can also find the allocation plan and other information as well. So there are several resources out there that should be updated. Obviously, as Dr. Tam, myself, or any of us find out more information, we will make sure that that information is disseminated to you appropriately. That is our job to do that. That is what we have done throughout this pandemic, and that is the one thing that we will continue to do is provide that information to you the best that we can. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch to talk about some of the questions that I have. So I'm going to read the question, and if I have partially answered this but do not feel that I answered it as well as I should through my discussion, it may be a little repetitive, so just bear with me. So the first question is, what is the plan to vaccinate everyone in other tiers? Well, our Tier 1A plan right now, we have moved from just vaccinating our team members, which is what was asked of us, to starting to vaccinate other tier or phase 1A frontline healthcare workers and others. So we have been doing that by identifying practices and healthcare workers in the community that have not been identified as receiving the vaccine yet. So as we identify those, we are reaching out as we have vaccine and slots available in order to make sure that they have an invitation in order to receive the vaccine. So we are handling Tier 1A and that type of approach. Tier 1B will be different because we are going from obviously having hundreds to a few thousand people to having many thousands of people who open up for vaccine in Tier 1B. So we are looking at many different strategies, and some of those strategies depend on how much vaccine is going to be allocated to BB for administration. And I say that to you because if our allocation or how much vaccine that we're going to receive is 1,000, that's a completely different plan than if we're going to receive 10,000 vaccines. What we do not want is to receive, for example, 10,000 vaccines and have many of them sitting on the shelves because we do not have a plan in place to vaccinate as efficiently, safely, and effectively as possible. So we are actually forming several plans so that way we can institute any of them depending on how many vaccines that we receive. My next question is, if we are only part-time residents here, how do we know where we should get the vaccine? Well, hopefully between the Division of Public Health in the state of Delaware and BB Healthcare and other resources, you will be able to identify the opportunities for vaccination. So more information will be sent out as that information becomes available to us. My next question is, will we need a prescription for the vaccine? If we are out of state, will we have to travel to Delaware to get the prescription? And then can we take it to BB to have the vaccination if we do not have a local doctor? So first of all, that's a really good question. And I'm gonna do the best answering that question with the information that I have. But as Dr. Tam alluded to at the very beginning, information changes fairly quickly. And as our plans have not solidified yet, this could change. So that's my disclaimer. So you probably will not need a prescription for the vaccine. But if you do have a primary care physician in the area, they may refer you to potentially a vaccine clinic. What I imagine will happen is that we will have vaccine clinics in however shape or form that they will look, that we will have patients refer to us for the COVID-19 vaccine. Now, at the same time, there will likely be other areas and other places where people who will just have to identify their age and they will be able to get the vaccine. Some of that planning is, and I will say more than some, most of that planning is still being worked out with the state to ensure that we have different avenues and different venues for as many people to be vaccinated as quickly as possible. So probably more to come on that. But for right now, it will likely not need a prescription, but if you do have a local primary care physician that may be able to help you answer questions about the vaccine, you may want to speak to that person as time gets closer to the rollout. My next question is, will the new strain of COVID-19 found in Great Britain and now in the United States require a new vaccine to be developed, or will the existing vaccines provide adequate protection? So what we know about the Moderna and Pfizer vaccine is that it appears that both of those vaccines are effective against that new strain that they are dubbing the UK strain and also known as the B.1.1.7 strain. So both of those vaccines at this point appear to provide adequate protection. My next question is, they say those who have had COVID-19 have immunity for up to 90 days, yet there are reports of people getting COVID-19 again before their 90 days are over. So how can we be sure that there really is immunity? So there are a couple case reports of patients who have had documented COVID-19 reinfection within the course of the first 90 days. Those are very few case reports that we are aware of at this point. The majority of people, so I will say 98, 99+% of people who end up with COVID-19 will have immunity at least for 3 months. And I imagine that over the course of the next few weeks, that new literature will support that there's actual immunity for longer than 3 months for the majority of people. But for right now, 90 days is what most of the general population or most of us would have if we had contracted COVID-19 or if we had contracted COVID-19. Does contracting the COVID-19 virus provide you with immunity such as occurs with measles or chickenpox. So I interpret this question as, does the if you do contract the COVID-19 virus, does it provide almost a lifelong immunity? Well, we're not quite sure the percentage of people right now that it does provide a lifelong immunity for, since COVID-19 virus has only been identified about 12 plus months ago. We are still following people who we know who have had COVID-19 in order to see how long that they have detectable antibodies and how long their immunity seems to last. So we don't know the answer to that at this moment. If I tested positive, isolated, and remained asymptomatic for over a month, is there any waiting period I have before getting the vaccine? Well, some recommendations are for you to wait for 90 days until you receive the vaccine, but that is not because the vaccine is going to hurt you if you did receive it. It's just because you are presumed to have immunity for at least 90 days. And as the vaccine is still an allocated resource, meaning not everyone who wants it can get it right now, they're asking people who have had COVID-19, if possible, to wait 90 days to allow others who may not have any immunity to COVID-19 to receive the vaccine. So that's where that 90-day period comes from. Will we get to pick which vaccine we receive? And if so, how will we be notified of which vaccine is available, when and where? That's a good question. So at this time right now, there is not much choice of which vaccine, or very little choice of which vaccine. So for instance, we initially had Pfizer vaccine, but now at this point, the Pfizer vaccine distributions have decreased, and now we are getting Moderna vaccine. So we actually will have Moderna vaccine, but we will not have Pfizer vaccine. But that may change over the course of the next few weeks, and we may end up having both vaccines again. So at that time, we will make that decision if we have the availability to provide one or the other. It is important to know that we do try to stick with whoever had a Pfizer for their first dose should receive a Pfizer for their second dose, and whoever received a Moderna for their first dose should receive a Moderna for their second dose. So they should not ideally be mixed. So it shouldn't be a Pfizer to a Moderna or a Moderna to a Pfizer. So it's very important for us in the background to also know what vaccine people have been provided so we can make sure that they receive the same vaccine when it is due for their second dose in 3 or 4 weeks, depending on the vaccine. My next question is, the state lists those with pre-existing conditions as those who will be able to get the vaccine, those who will be able to get the vaccine in January. However, what specific pre-existing conditions are they referring to? So there is a list of pre-existing conditions that are out there, but I do want to just class. I just want to take a moment to discuss this again. So in 1A, which are the healthcare personnel along with the long-term care facility residents and staff, those are the people who make up that top tier of 1A. In 1B, the way that the state has defined that next tier, or that tier that's underneath 1A, that is all frontline essential workers that were not included in tier 1A, and then also persons who are 65 years and older, and they don't necessarily break it down by medical conditions. When you move to the remainder of what the state of Delaware states is remaining phase one, that's where you then have the people who are age 16 to 64 with high-risk medical conditions. And those high-risk medical conditions include obesity, diabetes, COPD, heart conditions, chronic kidney disease, cancers, smokers, solid organ transplant recipients, sickle cell disease, also those with intellectual and development disabilities, severe and persistent mental behavioral health conditions as well. Now, also in that group are high-risk congregate settings, people who live in certain type of settings that include homeless shelters, group homes, and correction facilities. Now, I do want to give a disclaimer that the state of Delaware has only released 1A and 1B, meaning that those are the only two categories at this moment that have been voted on. So this other remaining phase one still is waiting to be voted on by the state of Delaware if they will further put that into additional tiers or if they will lump all those together. And I will admit that I am not quite sure what they will do with that. My next question is, my loved one is my caregiver. I am in the over 65 group with health issues. Will my caregiver be able to get the vaccine at the same time that I do so we are both protected? So the way that this is, written right now is that the person who, I believe who is asking the question, who is over 65, would fall in the 1B, would fall into the 1B category. And the caregiver, I'm not sure what age that person is, but a direct care provider, if that is how they are classified, actually falls into the 1A category. So there might be a little bit more of a definition there that I'm not able to interpret from this question, but that person may actually fall into a 1A. So that would be a question to potentially ask a primary care physician or even the state of Delaware COVID vaccine hotline to see if they can help find where that care provider falls. I'm just looking over real quick. I do have one question. I have two more questions and then I'm gonna close with a couple remarks and pass back. One question is, should people who have had Guillain-Barré syndrome get the vaccine? We are not supposed to receive the flu vaccine or the shingles vaccine. I personally had been refused the tetanus vaccine in the past. Well, my first and my normal disclaimer here is that I don't want to give out individual medical advice. So I'm going to tell you to please speak to your provider. So please talk to your healthcare member who normally gives you vaccines. But I can tell you that at least at this point, there is no contraindication to receive the Moderna or Pfizer vaccine for someone who has had Guillain-Barré syndrome before. And that is as of 5 p.m. on January 8th. So I would ask you again to speak to your provider, but there is no listed contraindication for the Moderna or the Pfizer COVID-19 vaccine for those who have had Guillain-Barré syndrome before. The last question is a very specific question, and I'm going to do my best to answer this, but I may not do it justice, so I apologize. What do you want to see for an oxygen level before a patient goes or stays on a ventilator? So there's actually a lot of factors here, and I think this is important to know. While the oxygen level of someone is one of the most important parameters to decide when someone should go on a ventilator and when someone should come off, it is not the only thing. There are other things that are being looked at, including how hard the person is in breathing. If someone is breathing very fast, and even though they are breathing extremely fast to try to compensate and keep their oxygen levels up, we all know that people can get tired from that. So we do not want someone to just stop breathing because they are breathing so rapidly, and that's their body's natural way to try to keep their oxygen levels up. So there's a little bit more to this than just oxygen levels of when someone would go on a ventilator or come off of a ventilator. There are things that we do before we just put somebody on a ventilator in some of those situations. So I appreciate all those questions and I hope they were helpful to the people who asked those. I just want to close for another couple minutes and then I'm going to pass this back to Dr. Tam. First of all, I hope I did not bore you and I hope this information was helpful to you and I appreciate all of you for hanging in there. I do want to say just a couple things. We are all in this together. And like I alluded to before, here we are a year out. And I know that we're all frustrated and we all want to get back to whatever that normal is for us. And normal is something different for every single one of us. But I think it's extremely important for all of you to please remember the three W's, even after becoming vaccinated. The vaccine and the point of the vaccine is to make sure that if you were to become infected with the virus, even after the vaccine, that it does not make you as severely ill as it potentially could have. So there still is a chance of becoming infected with a COVID virus, even after receiving the vaccine, especially after only receiving one dose of the vaccine. And I say that because it's so important for all of us to continue to follow the three W's, even after we receive one and both shots or injections of our COVID vaccine. And what I mean by the three W's is all the things that have been talked about for the last year: wash your hands, wear a mask, and watch your distance. Those three things are still the things that will continue to keep us safe and hopefully stop many, many infections and hopefully keep people out of the hospital. If you have not received your flu vaccine and you are someone who is eligible for the flu vaccine, please get it. It is not too late. We are just starting flu season right now, and the last thing any of us need is to get the flu and COVID on top of it. So please consider getting the flu vaccine if you can. And if you are ill, please don't bunker down at home. It's important for you to reach out to your healthcare team, seek medical attention if you need to. It is extremely important that you are taken care of as we are going into flu season and respiratory season, be it from COVID, the flu, or any of the other any of the other medical issues that you may have or unfortunately may develop. I again just want to thank you for your time, and I appreciate it. Please be safe, and if you have any questions, you know where to find me. This is back to you, Dr. Tam. Thank you.
What is happening and what's going on? I'll finish off with a few things. Number one, I want to tell you that at the hospital, at the medical center, you know, we are facing actually the expected peak of patients following Christmas and New Year. We are now seeing a large number of patients admitted to the hospital, and unfortunately, we actually expected this to some extent because it is now, what, 14 days plus minus after Christmas. What does that mean? It means that we expect to continue seeing a large number of patients here at the medical center over the next couple of weeks as people who might have been infected or exposed between Christmas and the New Year season will then eventually present themselves with illness, and we are prepared for it. That said, we are very busy right now, and the staff have been doing an amazing job of working very hard to take care of the needs of the community. And I ask that you remain diligent, that you pay attention, because there may be changes in our service delivery over the next several weeks as we face significant volumes here in the hospital. I don't want to do that, but I also want to make sure that the care we deliver is safe and of high quality. And what that means is I'm asking all of you that if you have procedures scheduled, that you remain in close contact with your doctor, with your surgeon, with your gastroenterologist, so that you will know as soon as we know if there is a change in your schedule. As I said, I don't want to do that because people are getting their surgeries and their procedures, their colonoscopies. That's important, but we want to ensure that when we do those procedures, it is done safely and of high quality, and that requires staff. And we are at a point where we are using every resource available to ensure that the patients in the hospital are being taken care of. So please stay tuned through Facebook, through other mediums, and to check with your doctor. Number two, I want to thank the community for everything that you are doing, especially our donors, especially our 1916 Club members, because they have you have supported us throughout this entire pandemic. That said, we need your help. we continue to need the help of the community. My team needs your help. They have worked tirelessly, 10 months straight. All of us have faced some type of personal tragedy or difficulty as a result of the pandemic. We're not immune to it. And they've still continued to work hard, innovate every single day. We recognize that it is a privilege to be your healthcare provider here in Sussex County, but it has been hard for my team. And so please, it's time now to break out those neighborhood signs, the chalking of driveways. It's time, please, to recognize your neighborhood heroes. Thank Team Beebe for all that they are doing when you see them. It is our privilege to care for you, but the heroes that work here in our clinics, in our ERs, every single day now need your support and your help more than ever as we get through what I'm considering the darkest part of the night before the dawn. The last thing I'll talk about is hope. So, you know, I was looking at my calendar, and next week will be the 49th anniversary of when my family immigrated to the United States from Japan. You know, my mom and dad had hope that my sister and I would actually have a better life here in America. And so they sacrificed everything. You know, they came just with a few things because we had the opportunity to come to the States. And, you know, my dad passed away in October of 2019. And I have to tell you that when I'm walking on the Breakwater and Junction Trail, I hope he's looking down and seeing that his sacrifice was not for naught, that, you know, I was able to do something to serve other people. And so, you know, I need you now to recognize that we still need a few more weeks of sacrifice, that we need to think about how to wash our hands, watch our distance, wear a mask. It's so hard. I understand that. I haven't seen my mom or touched her in 10 months, but we need to do this for just a little bit longer, everybody. We're all in this together. The vaccine works. The vaccine will help us, but we need to get through that point and make sure that we are staying away, that we're staying safe, so that the health system and our community can remain safe during this last part of the pandemic. You know, I came here with the hope that we would build a better health system, and I think we are on the track of doing so. Despite the pandemic, what do? We brought in more doctors. We brought in more surgeons, neurosurgeons, urologists, endocrinologists, primary care. We opened a new cancer center. We opened a new emergency room. We opened January 5th, a new family practice clinic in Millsboro. There are so many things that Beebe Healthcare is ready and poised to do as we continue through this, and we need your support as we get through the pandemic, as we stay safe, and then we as a community can celebrate by continuing to improve the health of everyone. So, the hospital is here. We need your help, and we know that we will continue to have hope together. Wash your hands, watch your distance, wear a mask. We will be here to do everything we can to get you vaccinated as fast as possible, bending the rules when we can to make sure that we take care of you here in Sussex County, and we need your help. My team members, my staff need your help. So, it's time for all of us, please, to work together so we can support each other. And we will bring you all the information as soon as it is available. Thank you so much for your support. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you, all Beebe team members, for the work that you do, as well as all other healthcare providers in the county who are doing everything to help the community during this time. On behalf of everybody here at Beebe Healthcare, thank you so much. And continue to follow us. Continue to follow us on Facebook. The information about everything from the state's hotline to all the information that we have for you, we will have ready and available. Thank you very much for paying attention, and we hope to see you very soon. Take care.